In the interest of time, let's go ahead and get started. I appreciate everybody being here and punctual this morning, or now this afternoon. So good afternoon. My name is Tim Daly, director of the Joyce Foundation's Gun Violence Prevention and Justice Reform Program. And thank you for joining today's discussion in our Lunch and Learn webinar series on emerging research into gun violence. For today's discussion, we are joined by experts from Johns Hopkins University to discuss their forthcoming research on the changing landscape of concealed carry laws. Before we dig into the details of today's discussions, a few housekeeping items. First, today's webinar is being recorded and in the coming days will be made available on the Joyce Foundation's website. And after today's discussion, we will be sure to share the presenter's slide deck and other key materials that are referenced in the webinar. Again, today's webinar will last 1 hour with the final 20 minutes being reserved for your questions. And to that end, if you have a question for today's speaker, please include it in the Q&A feature found at the bottom of your screen. I would encourage you to submit your questions as you think of them, even if the speakers are still presenting. With that housekeeping aside, let's jump into today's discussion. Over the last 25 years, the public debate over the risks and benefits of civilian gun carrying has often relied on questionable research that in turn has fueled the passage of increasingly permissive state laws. Recent research by professors John Donahue and Ian Ayers called into question much of this research after finding that right to carry laws that allow for concealed carry handgun permits to be issued to any applicant who meets basic criteria tend to lead to more violent crime, including homicides. Notwithstanding these latest findings, in just a few weeks' time, the U.S. Supreme Court will be hearing arguments in the most significant gun case to be decided since 2008's District of Columbia versus Heller. In the case New York State Rifle and Pistol Association versus Bruin, the court will soon be deciding on the constitutionality of New York's proper cause law regulating handgun carry licenses. Given the dramatically changing legal landscape regarding these concealed carry gun laws and the prospects of even greater change following the court's decision in Bruin, we're joined today by experts from the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Prevention and Policy to discuss their forthcoming research on how changes to state concealed carry gun laws impact violent crime and police-involved shootings. Today, we'll hear from three speakers, Cassasandra Crifasi, an assistant professor at the Johns Hopkins University Department of Health Policy and Management. She's also the deputy director of the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Prevention and Policy and a core faculty member in the Center for Injury Research and Policy. Alex McCourt is an assistant scientist in the Department of Public Health Department of Health Policy and Management at the Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, and is also affiliated with the Center for Gun Policy and Research. And Mitchell Doucette, also an assistant scientist in the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Doctors Crifasi, McCourt, and Doucette, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much, Tim. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes to kind of set the stage for the work that you're going to hear from Dr. McCourt and Dr. Doucette that we've been doing. Tim mentioned the work that John Donahue and colleagues had been doing, looking at right to carry laws and their impact on crime and violence. And one of the things that our center has been focused on, largely because of the expertise of Dr. McCourt as a public health lawyer, is really looking at some of the different flavors that these laws take. A lot of the work looking at concealed carry laws has sort of taken a black or white approach. You're either may issue or shall issue and permitless being lumped together as right to carry. And what we've been focused on is more about the spectrum of flavors that these laws might take. And some of my own experience as a gun owner, having gone through some of these concealed carry licensing classes in Florida and Utah, for example, really has informed the way we think about this and ways that we might put better standards in place in shall issue states to mitigate some of the potential harms. And another piece I'll just briefly mention, we've been anticipating some of these changes to concealed carry laws and have been asking public opinion polling questions since 2019. And something that we find very concerning is the trend toward lowering standards or removing permitting requirements is in direct opposition to the public opinion polling data. Very few people support permitless concealed carry, and the vast majority of people want higher standards in place. And so with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. McCourt to kick things off.
Thank you so much. And thanks everybody for being here. I'm really excited to get the chance to talk through some of the work we've been doing. So I'm going to get us started before turning over to Dr. Doucette on some of the legal changes and policy shifts that we are studying. Then I'll talk a little bit about how those shifts have affected violent crime. Briefly want to just acknowledge my collaborators here, all at Johns Hopkins and most of whom are on the webinar today. I also want to thank the Joyce Foundation for hosting this today and also for their generous funding of this work. So you've heard a little bit so far about state concealed carry policy and kind of how different states might regulate the carry of guns in public. When we talk about concealed carry, we're talking about people carrying a gun that is hidden. You can't see it, usually a handgun. It's in a holster, it's under someone's clothing, maybe in a bag. This is distinct from open carry, which we saw a lot in the summer of 2020 when people were at protests and they were bringing big long guns and rifles over their shoulders. That's open carry. That's regulated slightly differently and is often used for different purposes. Here we're focused on concealed carry. Most states require a permit or a license to carry a concealed gun, and they articulate specific permitting criteria for doing so. All of these processes involve a background check. So if a state requires a permit, you have to undergo a background check to apply for that permit, and you have to meet certain criteria. You have to not have prohibiting conditions that would keep you from possessing or carrying a gun. You may need to undergo training. There are some others, and we'll get into those in a minute. The overall policy, a state's overall policy, can be sorted into four buckets. The first, the strictest of these, is called a no issue or a ban. In these states, states that have a no issue policy, concealed carry is largely banned. They don't issue permits, and you can't carry a concealed weapon in public, with very small exceptions, maybe for off-duty law enforcement. Next, we have may issue laws. In states with a may issue law, concealed carry is allowed as long as you have a concealed carry permit. To get that permit, you have to meet specific statutory permitting criteria. Once you meet that criteria, however, law enforcement has the discretion to deny your application. They can say, okay, fine, you meet the criteria, but we still think you might be a dangerous person, or we don't think that you should have a gun in public, and they can deny it. So there is a permit, but it can be difficult to get it. Then there are shall issue laws. In states with shall issue laws, there are might be identical statutory criteria to a may issue state, but there is little to no discretion. So in almost all cases, if you meet the statutory criteria, the state is required to issue a concealed carry permit to you. For this reason, it's much easier to get a concealed carry permit in states with this law. Finally, the most lenient policy allows for permitless carry. In these states, a permit is not required. So you can carry a handgun concealed in public without applying for a permit or securing a permit. As long as you are a legal gun possessor and you are maybe of a proper age, you can carry in public. These last two categories, shall issue and permitless, are often lumped together and called right to carry laws. Both Tim and Dr. Crifasi mentioned some of the kind of the research trajectory for concealed carry policies. There was initial work in the 1990s by Lawton Mustard and a few others that argued and found that more guns meant less crime. So when states were adopting these shall issue laws, they were seeing decreases in crime. This was a surprising finding. This wasn't what most people expected. And it's turned out as time has gone on and we evaluated their methodology, it's been found to be flawed. Newer studies have in fact found the opposite. They found that states that have made it easier to get a permit have seen elevated violent crime rates. And John Donahue's work, among others, is really the standard for making this claim. However, some of these newer studies have flaws in the way that they talk about and analyze the laws. RAND recently released a summary report on all gun policy, and one specific area they focused on was concealed carry. They documented several different studies with many, many different outcomes, strengths, and weaknesses, and basically reached the conclusion that more research is necessary. These newer studies are generally better, but they're still pretty limited. They often focus on right to carry laws as a group that, in my opinion, improperly combines shall issue and permitless laws. Those are two discrete policies that might have different effects. They also focus on these overall policy categories instead of looking at specific permitting standards that may help reduce violence. They may help keep high-risk applicants from acquiring permits, and they may encourage responsible gun ownership and use. Here we tried to answer an overarching research question. Are state concealed carry policies associated with violent crime rates, and do specific permitting standards affect that association? This had two pieces. The first was a longitudinal legal mapping and analysis, and the second was a quantitative policy evaluation. First, I'll talk about the legal mapping. To do this, we asked specific legal research questions about how states were regulating concealed carry and how that was changing over time. We used standardized search terms in standard common legal databases for all 50 states from 1980 to the present. The collected laws were coded for their overall permitting policy and also for specific permitting standards. Over the next couple slides, I'm going to talk through by decade how these laws have evolved over the last 40 years. On the left is 1980, how the country looked in 1980. States that are green, which is really the majority of the Midwest and bits of the South, banned concealed carry. They were no issue states. States that are blue had may issue laws, which was the most common policy at the time. There are just four states that made it relatively straightforward or easier to get a concealed carry permit: Washington, Indiana, New Hampshire, and Rhode Island. And Vermont was the only state that allowed permitless carry in 1980. Over the next decade, not very much changed. A few more states started allowing concealed carry, adopting either may issue or shall issue laws. So there are a handful more states with shall issue laws and with may issue laws, but there's still a solid majority of the country that either has a ban on concealed carry or makes it somewhat difficult to get a permit, maintaining law enforcement discretion. Now, during the 1990s is when we saw some of this more guns, less crime research that we ultimately found to be flawed, but at the time, was influential and was influential both politically and academically. And, policymakers were kind of scrambling to deal with actual increases in crime, but also perceived increases in crime. And they were searching for policy solutions. So there were many different things that happened during the 1990s with respect to gun policy. One of these was absolutely efforts to deregulate concealed carry. In the 1990s, there was a significant deregulation. By 2000, the majority of the country has adopted a shall issue law. There are still seven states that ban concealed carry, but that is significantly fewer than we saw in the 80s and early 90s. There are still several may issue states, but again, the majority have shall issue laws. By 2010, that trend has continued. There are only two states left that ban concealed carry, Illinois and Wisconsin. The vast majority of the country is under a shall issue law. And while there are still may issue laws, there are significantly fewer. In addition, Arizona and Alaska have both adopted a permitless law. Alaska adopted theirs in 2003, and Arizona adopted permitless law in 2010. Things have continued to deregulate through the present. All states now allow concealed carry. There are no more no-issue states. There are just eight states left that have may-issue laws. And these are kind of what you might call the usual suspects: California, Hawaii, New York, Massachusetts, Connecticut, New Jersey, Delaware, and Maryland. States that have traditionally strict gun policies. There are 21 states with shall-issue laws. Now, this is actually a decrease from 2010, in part because many shall-issue states have actually moved to a permitless law. There were three states with a permitless law in 2010. As of October 2021, there are 21 states that allow permitless carry. So this is yet another deregulatory shift toward making it easier and more straightforward to carry a concealed gun in public. But this is only part of the story. These laws were not just reviewed for their overall policy, but also for their specific permitting standards. When someone actually has to get a concealed carry permit, what requirements do they have to meet in each state? We found several common standards that were relevant to violence prevention. Prohibitions for conviction for a violent misdemeanor, requirements that you undergo training, a requirement that you actually handle a gun and engage in live fire on a range, requirement that law enforcement engage in an evaluation to determine whether you are a danger to yourself or others, and kind of amorphous broad suitability requirements that say things like, an applicant must be suitable to be so licensed, but doesn't really define that. So it's kind of a narrow discretion that is afforded to law enforcement. Alongside the shift to shall issue in the 90s and the early aughts, we actually saw an increase in permitting standards in those states. As states were decreasing discretion for law enforcement, they were kind of replacing it by adding specific standards. In this table, we can kind of see how that played out. So in the left two columns is 1980 states that required a permit, either with a may issue law or a shall issue law. And then on the right two columns is 2019 with two columns for may issue and shall issue. The rows are each of these permitting standards that I just described. So you can see on the right side or on the left side in 1980, most of the states that require a permit have a may issue law, but really these top four standards are not very common. Maybe one, two, or maybe three states have a violent misdemeanor prohibition, required training, et cetera. And virtually no shall issue states have these policies. Other suitability standards, this broad amorphous standard, is actually, those are pretty common. About three quarters of each policy includes some kind of suitability evaluation. By 2019, things changed considerably. So we saw a big shift toward shall issue. Now the majority of states that require a permit are shall issue states. 69% of those states have a violent misdemeanor prohibition. Around 76% require training of shall issue states. Just under half of states require live fire demonstration or live fire training on a range. And about 45% do a dangerousness evaluation. The number of shall issue states with a suitability standard has decreased quite a bit. The share of states that evaluate an applicant's suitability without a specific definition of suitability has decreased to just 14%. So overall, we've seen much a growth in the number of permitting standards. So how have these overall policies and these specific permitting standards affected violent crime? So that was the next piece. We wanted to evaluate the relationship between all of these different policies and violent crime outcomes. There were two pieces to this quantitative analysis. There was an interrupted time series approach and also an augmented synthetic control model with random effects meta-analysis. Our dependent variables for 1980 to 2019 were different measures of violent crime: aggravated assault with a firearm, robbery with a firearm, firearm homicide, and non-firearm homicide. For our regression models, we use negative binomial regression with state and year fixed effects. I'll talk about the different policy variables in a moment, but our legal covariates were a set of gun policies that have been shown by prior research to have an association with violent crime. Finally, we included a set of state demographic covariates that are listed here, but I'm not going to describe them in detail. We ran several different regression models that had different kind of variations of concealed carry policies. First, we had just the broad concealed carry policy. Did a state have a permitless policy, a shall issue policy, a may issue policy? Second, we ran a series of models where shall issue was broken into two groups, one with a permitting standard and one without, for each of the listed policies that I've been talking about. Our augmented synthetic control models were somewhat similar, and we ran these because there is concern that that the regression models might have some limitations. So we wanted to do both of these modeling strategies to try to triangulate, to understand how this how these policies affect the outcomes from multiple different perspectives. We ran state-specific models that we were then able to generate average effects through a random effects meta-analysis. This is an extension of the synthetic control method. You create a synthetic state that's a weighted combination of untreated states that approximates both the covariates and the outcomes in the period leading up to passage of the law. You then compare the difference between the state that adopted the law and the synthetic state in the post-law period. Augmented synthetic control represents an improvement over synthetic control in at least one way, which is that it uses an outcome model to minimize the pre-law root mean square prediction error. In other words, it uses an outcome model to try to make that pre-law fit as good as it can possibly be. We used identical demographic covariates. We did not use the legal covariates for this method because it's difficult to include them in this modeling strategy. And our models ran from 10 years pre-law to 10 years post-law in each state. So in the interest of time, I'm going to run through the results, but I'm not going to get into specifics. But I want to flag for if you are looking at these slides now, or if you look at them later, that the regression models and the synthetic control models produce two different types of estimates. The regression models estimate an incidence rate ratio, and the synthetic control models estimate an average treatment effect on the treated. So you can't really compare the magnitude of these estimates to each other, but you can get a general idea from each one what effects the law might be having. So first, for May issue laws. Across all models, states with May issue laws saw a lower level of violent crime relative to states with shall issue laws in the regression models. For synthetic control, the results were largely consistent with regression, although we saw the biggest protective effect for aggravated assault with a firearm. We saw a small effect for homicide with a firearm and no real changes for robbery or non-firearm homicide. The results for permitless laws were somewhat surprising. In the regression models, permitless laws were less consistent, but states actually generally saw lower levels of assault and robbery and no change in homicide relative to shall issue laws. In the synthetic control, we actually saw nothing statistically significant, but trends that kind of pointed in the same direction as the regression. Next, I'm going to talk about the shall issue laws with each of these different permitting standards. So first, with live fire training. So when we actually see an increase in robbery with a firearm in states that had that policy. I apologize if I'm cutting out. I just got a note about my internet stability. In the synthetic control models, we saw something similar, although we did see that moving from May issue to shall issue without live fire was protective. We saw significantly harmful effects when live fire was not included. We saw an increase in aggravated assault, homicide, both firearm and non-firearm, but we did not see that when the live fire requirement was included. For the violent misdemeanor prohibition, this was protective across all outcomes in the regression. In the synthetic control method modeling, we only saw a fairly large protective effect with aggravated assault with a firearm, where when that prohibition was not included, there was a large increase in aggravated assault with a firearm, but when it was included, we saw no change. For the suitability requirement, we saw a protective effect across all outcomes except for homicide with a firearm in the regression models. In the synthetic control models, we saw a protective effect for aggravated assault with a firearm and homicide with a firearm. Dangerousness, we actually saw the fewest significant results. We saw a small decrease in robbery with a firearm. And actually, in the synthetic control modeling, we saw the opposite, which was an increase in robbery with addition of this policy, suggesting we need to dig in a little bit more to figure out where this difference comes from. So the legal mapping reveals important nuances in state concealed carry policies. Overall, our work is consistent with prior studies. May issue laws appear to be protective relative to shall issue laws, even with the addition of specific provisions. Specific permitting standards, however, may hold promise as a mechanism for reducing or preventing increases in violence. There are some differences between the regression and the synthetic control results, but in general, violent misdemeanor and training-related provisions may be protective. Our permitless results were somewhat unexpected. So what could explain either no change in shifting from shall issue to permitless or actually a protective effect? Well, it could be that more firearms in public means that crime is deterred. We think this is unlikely given the results for shifts from may issue to shall issue. Because we see increases when moving from may issue to shall issue, we expect that this is not what's happening. We would see a similar effect from shall issue to permitless. More likely, there's an omitted variable. There's something that we're not accounting for that explains increases in crime in states that did not have a permitless law or decreases in crime in states that do. Finally, shall issue laws may increase violence. Specific permitting standards within shall issue laws may be protective, but we also need to evaluate equity and impact. These kind of open the door to discrimination when there is too much discretion afforded to law enforcement. We also need more quantitative analyses to fully understand the relationship between these permitting standards and fatal outcomes. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Doucette.
All right, thank you very much, Dr. McCourt. I'm just gonna look at everything's good. I'm assuming everything is good on everyone else's end. That's great to hear. So again, my name is Mitch Doucette, and I'm an assistant scientist in the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Prevention and Policy. Thank you to Tim, thank you to Dr. McCourt and Dr. Crifasi so far. Today I'm gonna be talking about officer-involved shootings and concealed carry weapons permitting laws from 2014 to 2020. I just want to take a brief moment to give a roadmap of where we'll be going. First, I'll discuss the relationship between officer-involved shootings and firearms, discuss the methodology of this work, as well as results and some implications. So in 2019, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reported about 652 legal intervention deaths or deaths of civilians by law enforcement officers, most of which were the results of an officer-involved shooting. However, this count is incomplete. Data from the CDC relies on death certificates, which often undercount or misclassify police involvement in homicides. And recent attempts to quantify officer-involved shootings using media reports and other sources have generated estimates significantly higher than that of the federal government. So sources such as the Fatal Force developed by Washington Post, the Counter developed by The Guardian, and the Gun Violence Archives, as well as others, estimate the number of officer-involved shootings are closer to about 1,000 per year. And of note, the Gun Violence Archive is the only source that provides an accounting of both fatal and non-fatal officer-involved shooting victimization. Research using these web-based estimates have found several important characteristics. So first, across different data sources and studies, we see continuously that Black non-Hispanics are disproportionately killed by police. And second, we see that the armed environment plays a role in officer-involved shootings. So I'm going to spend a few minutes now discussing officer-involved shooting in the context of firearms. So research has identified that at the state level, states with weak firearm legislative environments have higher rates of fatal officer-involved shootings. Here, firearm legislative environments refers to the quantity of laws that we would associate with having lower rates of firearm violence. So in this image from Crivisto and colleagues, we use police shooting data from the Guardian's database that counted and examined the linear relationship here, showing that, again, fatal officer-involved shootings and firearm legislative scores were correlated here, meaning, again, the lower the scorecard, in this case, scorecards from the Brady Center, the higher the rates of fatal officer-involved shootings. Additionally, states with greater firearm availability have higher rates of fatal officer-involved shootings. So two studies have examined this relationship between firearm prevalence and fatal officer-involved shootings in the United States. Research from Hemingway and colleagues in 2018 used data from the Washington Post, finding rates of fatal officer-involved shootings per 1 million population were significantly associated with firearm availability at the state level. Here, firearm availability was measured as a proxy of the proportion of firearm suicides to suicides. And the authors hypothesized that this relationship between fatal officer-involved shootings and gun ownership may be due to increases in both the likelihood of an officer encountering an armed person and officers' perceived risk of injury in an encounter where gun ownership is prevalent. Notably, this work was essentially duplicated in 2020, finding similar correlations with a similar data set. So the problem. The book, When Police Kill, provides an in-depth analysis of the counted data set. And in 2016, we know that the majority of fatal officer-involved shootings occurred outside the home as part of incidents related to criminal investigations, patrols, traffic stops. And previous research has identified that victims are largely armed at the time of an encounter. And concealed carry weapons laws were discussed earlier in the panel, so I'm not gonna go too much into them now, but we can surmise that permissive concealed carry weapons laws lower barriers to gun carrying in public spaces. And really, as a survey of gun owners identifies this as likely as gun owners in states with permissive concealed carry laws report greater proportions of loaded gun carrying in public compared to may issue states. This way hypothesized that the adoption of permitless concealed carry laws would increase officer-involved shooting victimization rates. So the research question here was, what was the impact of adopting a permitless concealed carry law on officer-involved shooting rates? And to answer this question, we wanted to measure the causal impact of adopting a permitless concealed carry law on officer-involved shooting rates from 2014 to 2020 using data from the Gun Violence Archive. And to do this, we used an augmented synthetic control method to compare what would have happened in states had permitless concealed carry laws not been adopted. And importantly, we compared permitless adoption states to states with shall issue laws that did not change their law from 2014 to 2020. Because of our study period, this again equates to about 11 states that adopted a permitless concealed carry law during our time period. And law adoption was captured using legal research methods that were previously described. So the GVA is a nonprofit managed database of US gun violence and is updated daily from 7,500 media, law enforcement, governments, and commercial sources since 2013. And notably, the Gun Violence Archive is unique in that it's really the only web-based data source that provides both fatal and non-fatal officer-involved shooting outcomes. And importantly, having fatal and non-fatal outcomes is advantageous as it tells a more complete story of officer-involved shooting victimizations. And we abstracted cases flagged as an officer-involved incident and involved the officer using a gun, and which resulted in an injury or a fatality as a result. And for each incident, we identified the state, day of injury, as well as fatal and non-fatal counts of officer-involved shootings. Notably, the GVA does not provide race, ethnicity information for victims. So our outcome of interest for this analysis was in the counts of fatal and non-fatal officer-involved shootings, or the total number of victims, regardless of fatality. And we restricted the time periods from 2014 to 2020, in order to begin our analysis at a time when media reporting had started to become more consistent, reliable, and really this was determined through sensitivity analyses. And the covariates, and I'll just briefly mention them here, that we included in our analyses was the percent population living in a metropolitan statistical area, white non-Hispanic males aged 15 to 19, Black non-Hispanic males aged 15 to 19, as well as population rates of unemployment, law enforcement employment, and incarceration. Again, the data structure was a panel data set with repeated measures for 50 states, and we used population estimates to calculate rates of officer-involved shootings per 1 million population. Importantly, we constructed biannual rates of officer-involved shootings, or 14 state time indices over 7 years of data availability. No, I'm not going to go too much into the synthetic control method as that was previously discussed, but I will say a little bit here. We use the synthetic control, augmented synthetic control method to try to answer our research question. And again, just to kind of re-highlight here, this method is very similar to the synthetic control method in that it creates a weighted synthetic state based on covariate values. And they do so from a pool of non-treated states. And for our study, that was shallow issue states that didn't change their law during the time period. And for the synthetic control method, as well as the augmented synthetic control method, again, we really look to the pretreatment fit or the root mean square prediction error to give us an indication of the ability to make causal inference in the post-law adoption period. And this type of modeling creates a control state with limited selection bias, likely to satisfy the parallel line assumption necessary for causal inference. And it produces an average treatment effect on the treated, or an ATT. And again, we conducted 11 separate analyses for each of the permitless adopting states. In addition, again, as Dr. McCourt mentioned, we wanted to understand not just the state-specific effect of passing these laws, but the overall effect of adopting a permitless law from a shall issue law. And in order to do so, we used a random effects meta-analysis to calculate an inverse standard error weighted average of the overall effect. And again, we chose this method because it assumes a heterogeneous policy impact across adopting states, which the research suggests is most likely the case. Now, again, strong pretreatment fit, or that root mean square prediction error in the pre-adoption period, is really important for making causal inferences. And notably, 10 out of the 11 states that we examined displayed very strong pretreatment fit. And I'll kind of walk through one of them here. Among the states with strong pretreatment fit, four states displayed statistically significant increases in officer-involved shooting in the post-adoption period. An example here is Missouri's officer-involved shooting rate, which increased 27.6% above what we would have expected had the state not adopted a permitless concealed carry weapons law in 2017. And just to orient you to this image a little bit, the left-hand side is a graph of the difference or a difference plot between the augmented synthetic control and its treated state, and then the two trend lines for Missouri and its augmented synthetic state. We see here the root mean square prediction error, just for kind of a visual representation here, is actually 0.11. So if we added up the difference at each of the time points, it would result in a 0.11, or again, almost identical in the pre-adoption period. And visually, we can see that on the right-hand side. And again, this indicates very strong pretreatment fit and a fulfillment of the parallel line trend assumption. In the post-adoption period, the average treatment effect on the treated was 2.08 with a standard error of 0.53. Otherwise said, the average difference between the treated and synthetic state at each time point after law adoption is 2.08. And again, this translates to about a 27.6% increase in officer-involved victimization rates. Here we see the other permitless adopting states on the left-hand side of this image, their average treatment effect on the treated and as well as their standard error as part of the random effects meta-analysis. Overall, the adoption of a permitless concealed carry weapons law increased officer-involved shooting victimization rates 12.9% above what we would have expected had the law not been adopted. And just to situate us to this image here is Missouri highlighted. Its average treatment effect on the treated, 2.08 again, and standard error rounded to 0.53. And we also see that Idaho, Mississippi, Missouri, and West Virginia all had statistically significant increases. And importantly, no state saw statistically significant decreases as well. Overall, the inverse standard error weighted average was 0.78. And you can see the weights on the right-hand side of this figure. And again, this average difference translates to an additional four victims per year associated with law adoption, or a 12.9% increase in victimization rates above what we would have expected. Now, adopting a permitless concealed carry weapons law led to an increased officer-involved shooting victimization rates above what we would have expected had the law change not occurred. And policymakers should consider the negative health implications among the public when considering permitless concealed carry weapons law adoption. As less restrictive laws promote public civilian gun carrying, they may increase the probability that an officer meets an armed person in the line of duty. So between 75 and 95% of homicides of law enforcement officers are committed with a firearm. And it's likely that less restrictive concealed carry weapons laws increase an officer's perceived risk of personal injury during an encounter. And this in turn may increase the likelihood that deadly force is used. Importantly, we were not able to disaggregate our outcome by victim characteristics, as this information was not readily coded as part of the gun violence archive. Thus, a question that needs answering is if there are differential effects by race, ethnicity. And previous research has identified, again, that Black non-Hispanics are disproportionately killed at a rate, again, depending on study, around 3 times greater as part of officer-involved shootings. And really, a logical next aim of this research is to understand if our results here hold true for stratified analyses. So I want to thank you all for my time, acknowledge our funders of the Joyce Foundation and the New Venture Fund, and my co-authors as well. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you so much, Drs. Doucette and McCourt and Crifasi for going through all of that. We want to use the remaining time for questions. So I definitely invite all of the researchers to come back on the camera here. And if you do have a question, please do include it in the Q&A feature. And we're going to try and get to as many of those as we can in the time that we have remaining. There was one question in the chat that I do want to start with. They asked, will the slides be made available? And what is the status of the publication of this data? So I'll start with the slides. Yes, we're going to make sure that both slide decks are made available, but I will turn to the panel. Can you just speak to when you expect these results to be published in the weeks and months ahead?
Sure. So, thank you so much. We're really excited to publish them. The publication timeline, once it's submitted, is always a little bit difficult to predict, but we, I think, plan on submitting at least 2 manuscripts within, I would say, the next month. I think that's safe to say.
Great. All right, let's jump right into the questions. And again, if you have one, please put it in the chat. And so the first one here we'll jump into is, do you have any information addressing the possibility that the nature of permitting policies is a reflection of community attitudes towards gun use, and that those attitudes are what is driving levels of gun crime rather than the permitting practices, and that the relationship between attitudes and permitting may vary from location to location?
I can start and then...
Please.
So I think it's definitely possible that there are social and community norms that affect the way that these policies end up affecting violence and crime. I think that's undoubtedly true. And I think that you may even see that in the way that we're seeing some unexpected results related to permitless laws when it comes to violent crime. It may be that states that are making that shift have norms where all of the people that want to carry guns in public are already doing so with a shall issue permit. And so the change in policy doesn't actually change behavior very much. And so I think it's absolutely possible that is playing a role. What's difficult is getting data on that. It's difficult to analyze individual carrying behavior and social norms without doing more qualitative and survey-based research, which I think would be a really valuable next step, but is outside the scope of what we did here.
Got it. Mitch, anything to add there on that one?
No, I think I would certainly agree with what Dr. McCourt stated. I don't have too much more to add other than, again, trying to understand those trends and trying to understand their impact in the future.
Great. And then relatedly, the same person asked, do we know anything about the relationship between concealed carry, not the policy, but the actual level of gun concealed carrying and the relationship between that and shootings in any of these jurisdictions? And again, either for Alex or Mitch.
Sorry, I'm trying to find it. I'm sorry, I couldn't find the question in the chat, but is the question essentially, are we able to directly link the location to the gunshot?
No. We're just curious about the relationship between the actual carrying of guns, right? Not the policy, which clearly your relationship, your research was going into, but the levels of gun carrying in a community and the level of violence or gunshot.
I can jump in on that. To what Dr. McCourt mentioned, getting data on actual carrying can be very challenging, but some work that David Heroux and colleagues have done in Philadelphia, I believe, in some other jurisdictions, have found that when youth are carrying firearms, they are far more likely to become victims than when they're not carrying firearms. So they're perpetrators or victims of violence. And so there's research showing that when people have access to firearms, that can increase the lethality of different interactions. Having access to a firearm may increase the likelihood that you would engage in some kind of aggressive altercation. So we can't answer that question directly, but we know that for youth who are carrying firearms, the act of having that firearm available can increase their likelihood that they would be a victim of a shooting.
Super, super helpful. Thank you for that. Moving on to the next question. Someone just asked, just generally, if we were to sum up the studies that we just talked about, you know, is adopting permitless concealed carry a good idea or a bad idea?
So I can start. And then if anybody else has thoughts. So I think the lawyer and research answer to that question is it depends. And I think that what you lose when you adopt permitless is this connection between somebody who wants to carry a concealed weapon and the state government. So there's no longer this interaction where the state can be ensuring that this person is acting safely with their gun, is undergoing training. The state loses the ability to shape or affect behavior in a really meaningful way. And I think that the elements of the study looking at different aspects of these permitting standards and shall issue laws show that some of these specific standards can be protective. So if you have a shall issue law, we're seeing that there might be increases in violent crime, but if you have some of these higher permitting standards, that might help reduce the size of that increase. But if we see no effect of moving to a permitless law, then we're really losing the protective effect of those permitting standards. We risk not being able to get protection or not being able to even generate new standards that might help us reduce violence even more.
Yeah, I would just echo Dr. McCourt's comments and just thinking very specifically about the types of interactions that law enforcement and communities of color might have. For example, we know that there's a lot of over-policing in these communities, focusing on drug enforcement or proactive gun enforcement. If you are removing the requirement for individuals to get permits, you're removing sort of a quick way for law enforcement to be able to determine whether someone is lawfully carrying a firearm, which means you may, for example, have law enforcement sort of stopping and searching more people because there's no way for, there's not an easy way for them to necessarily assess legal carrying. So one concern we have is that it may lead to more unfair law enforcement in communities of color where they're just sort of targeting these groups where there may be expanded gun carrying as a result of permitless carry. And just to further build off of Dr. McCourt's point, when we're thinking about the barriers to entry for concealed carry that permitting standards put into place, although standing at a firing range and shooting at a paper target doesn't equate to using a gun sort of successfully in common situations you might encounter, at least you can hit a non-moving paper target at 20 feet, right, with sort of a certain level of accuracy. And you lose that in a lot of states when you go to permitless. And so if you can't hit a non-moving paper target at 20 feet, you know, how much more successful are you going to be successfully using your firearm in other situations? So those are the kinds of things that we're thinking about. And I would say, based on the work we're doing and some of the work that others are doing, generally, we would not say that permitless carry laws are going to be beneficial for public safety.
Great, thanks to you both. The next question was that in 2013, Illinois went from a total ban on concealed carry to granting permits on specific grounds. In the 8 years since, neither law enforcement nor gun control groups have cited holders of permits as a significant source of violent crime. And the viewer asks, does that suggest that the law had little or no impact?
I would just jump in really briefly and then I'll turn over to Alex and Mitch. I would say in general, in aggregate, people who apply for a license to law enforcement, go through training standards, pass a background check and sort of meet the often enhanced criteria for carrying a gun in public are generally lawful citizens, right? They've passed a background check and might not sort of lead to changes in violent crime themselves. But some of the concerns are if they're carrying a gun and they are going into a location where they can't carry, are they safely and securely storing their gun in their vehicle, or is it sort of available for theft? So it's not necessarily the permit holder themselves that might be leading to increases in violent crime, but changing the norms around them, changing access to firearms. And I'll defer to Dr. McCourt and Doucette if they have anything to add.
And I'll add too, again, we were talking specifically about violent crime. There could be, again, lower levels of crime that maybe aren't being recorded as either accurately or even at all, that again, maybe may involve a firearm, may not involve, say, the use of a firearm, but it could be, again, there could be some impact on that perhaps we're not recording as of right now.
Great. Let's go to the next question then. And this question is for Alex. The question was, can you say more about what you found on the impact of training requirements for concealed carry? Did you look at the impact of different levels of training required, for example?
That's a really great question. I think that training in general is something that would be really great to look more specifically at. The only iterations we looked at were training in general, just any training requirement, and live fire requirements. So going to a range and either just, some live fire requirements are fire 20 rounds, it doesn't matter what you hit, and that's the end of it. Others say, you have to hit the target 90% of the time to pass. So we found that these training related standards might be protective and that, in at least some cases, is particularly true when live fire is required. I think it's really important for future studies to look at different flavors of training requirements, because we didn't really talk about this in detail because of time, but the way that states implement training varies quite a bit. Some states, you can take a course online, you don't even have to live in the state, and it's a couple hours and then you're done. Other places you have to go for a day-long course in person, take time on the range, and cover many, many, many topics. So the content varies, the form of delivery varies, and the time on the range. And so I think in terms of, what is the best training policy, we need to do a little bit more work on that.
Great, thank you. And this question was for Dr. Doucette. Can you clarify if officer-involved shootings includes officers as victims of gun violence? The viewer would like to understand if permitless carry may also lead to an increase in the number of officers that are shot or killed based on your research.
Yeah, thank you for that. That's a great question. So again, I didn't go too much into detail during the talk, but I'll try to keep it brief here for the time. So this is our kind of first data abstraction where we took the gun violence archive data and we kind of went through case by case there's 16,000 cases to kind of go through and code. In this kind of initial round of abstraction, officers were included as victims because, again, that's how the gun violence archive includes them as part of the coding scheme. We weren't able to kind of tease those out to understand the direct impact for this analysis. And again, future analyses, we're actually going back and kind of recoding and making sure we have a good understanding of teasing those out of the victims on a year-to-year basis. Dr. Crifasi, anything to add to that?
Yeah, just clarify, it's a really small fraction of cases where the injury count includes an officer who was wounded as part of the incident, but there are some, and so we're doing a second pass based on data quality to check that. We have a plan for a secondary or subsequent analysis where we'll look specifically at fatal and non-fatal assaults against law enforcement officers that we're going to be running, but this is just focused on incidents where police are shooting and wounding civilians.
Great, thanks to you both. And we have time for just two more questions and then we'll have to wrap up. The next one is it true that gun crime tends to concentrate in local areas and is not uniformly distributed over cities or states? And if so, is making conclusions on statewide basis too gross?
I can just jump in really briefly. We know that there's geographic variation in crime. We know that even if you say in Baltimore City, which has an exceptionally high rate of gun violence, you could narrow into particular parts of the city. You could narrow down even further into neighborhoods and then even further to specific blocks. It's an exceptionally small group of sort of blocks within a city that is responsible or sort of experiences the highest rates of violence. And so there are reasons to think that a state level analysis might wash out or sort of regress to the mean some of the findings. We have done some other work where we've looked at county level, for example, looked at urban counties to see the impacts of some different policies. And in those, in that analysis, we found right to carry laws sort of broadly, the shall issue and permitless, were associated with increases in firearm homicides. So it is important to look at some of those smaller geographic variations, and that can be a subsequent unit of analysis that we explore for sure.
Great, thank you. All right, last question. It comes in and says, and this is for all of you, what do you hope policymakers and advocates take away from the findings of your studies discussed today? And Alex, why don't you go first?
Sure. So I think one really key thing is to understand the nuance in these policies. We've tended in the past to talk about these as very binary policies where you either have a may issue law or a shall issue law, and then kind of this new creation, which is permitless carry. And I think what we're showing here and what we're hoping to get across is that these little nuances and details matter quite a bit, and it may be effective and efficient for policymakers to focus on these little nuances that could help prevent violence and encourage responsible gun ownership without trying to reinvent concealed carry policy whole cloth.
Great, Dr. Doucette?
Again, I won't say, I'll leave some more of the policy discussions for Dr. Crifasi. I'll add that when we talk about advocates and policymakers, again, advocating for a better understanding of the for my study at least, officer involved shooting, but data in general, and trying to improve kind of the data quality that again is collected at the national level for all sorts of crimes, and that includes death records as well as crimes reported to the FBI. And again, I know that that's kind of like a whole nother can of worms, but the emphasis of data availability to be able to understand the implications of some of these policy decisions.
I would just end by saying, depending on what the Supreme Court says in June of 2022, you know, we may lose the option for states to have may issue that sort of broad discretion or requiring a good and substantial reason. So I'm hoping that folks will take from this research that there are elements of shall issue laws that can mitigate some of the harms we've seen, and that policymakers and advocates can think about violent misdemeanor prohibitions or live fire training requirements that they could put into place if they lose the ability to retain the may issue regime.
Great. Well, thank you all for participating today, and thanks to all of the folks who joined today's webinar. Again, the webinar was recorded and we'll make it available on the Joyce Foundation's website soon. And we'll also send around today's slide decks and other key materials that we discussed. And then finally, we're excited to announce the dates and topics of the next two webinars in our research lunch and learn series. On Tuesday, November 23rd, from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Central, we'll be discussing new research regarding juvenile delinquency, adult firearm access, and crime outcomes. More specifically, researchers from Duke University will be previewing new research on the rationale and effectiveness of age-based restrictions on their access to firearms that depend on the nature and severity of prior juvenile offenses. And then on this, on Friday, December 10th, from 12 to 1 p.m. Central, we'll be discussing new research examining the racial and socioeconomic disparities in violence that occurred during the COVID-19 pandemic, research that was led by folks from the Violence Prevention Research Program at the University of California at Davis. Again, further details, including links to register for both of those webinars, will be distributed by email in the days to come. Again, thanks to our speakers for joining us and for all of you for tuning in. Thank you so much and take care.